2016, and I'm so happy because we're finally starting to see World War II games crop up again. We have Day of Infamy, which is a reskinned Insurgency, and a couple of promising early access shooters coming up. One being Battalion 1944, which is looking to bring back the Call of Duty 2 shooter feel, and Days of War, which is also trying to emulate an old school shooter feel. Near enough, all of these games will feature retrospective maps, and avid World War II fans will certainly recognise them. I will touch more on these later. Just a little note before we get stuck into Day of Defeat. It bugs me a little when people say they got sick of World War II games. Understandably, the same old things in life can get monotonous, but I think World War II lends itself to game design very well, as everything is already perfected in terms of content. We've got weapons, environments, clear-cut axes and allies. It's all there. Game developers just need to make the gameplay and add some salt and pepper on the steak. I'm so glad to see World War II starting to seep back into the gaming world. The era is so diverse it almost sounds like fiction. I think all it will take is for a large developer to launch a World War II game and we will be back into the thick of World War II action like we used to be in the early 2000s. EA and DICE have very kindly stirred the WWII stew pot a little with the release of Battlefield 1. Hopefully in a couple of years time that World War II stew will be good enough to eat and everyone will want a bit of it. And that brings me on to Day of Defeat, one of the best World War II shooters that ever existed. Much like Counter-Strike, it was a free mod that received fully fledged updates and became a retail Valve game like you know it or may not know it today. I wanted to make this because there are no good retrospectives out there that document the actual period of Day of Defeat's popularity. I'll be covering stuff from the mod version, what it was like to be a fan of a mod, a concept that is sadly becoming a thing of the past, and even the nitty gritty stuff only true veterans will remember, such as mod to retail changes, the Day of Defeat forum dramas, the removal of bleeding, that'd be a good one, the secret FG42 on Dodd Charlie, and lots more if I can think of it. Day of Defeat was a big deal in its day, and I have to create a fitting tribute for it. The "lol, watch me play an old World War II shooter" videos out there, just no good. Day of Defeat needs a fitting send-off. For a lot of players, it was a very important game and a part of their lives that they probably won't forget. Even though it's just a little silly video game mod, it was really significant. So this video is going to please everybody. Anyone that played, anyone who hasn't played, it's going to be all about Dodd and there's nothing you can do about it. So sit back and enjoy a trip down mod history lane. Just before I get stuck in, I only began playing Dodd when it was beta 3.1. So I won't be covering pre-3.1 mod versions in detail, only because I was not there. I do recall the essence of these earlier versions from other players at the time. You know, Dodd Hill, the little turtle thing, then the grenade spam on the beach map. But I can't sit here and pretend that I played it. Sorry, super old Dodd vets. I'm sure you'll still enjoy what's coming up if you stick around and if you stuck with Dodd all of the way till the very end. If you have no idea what the concept of Day of Defeat is, here are the basics. It was a team-based shooter where you picked a class and each class had its own weapons. Each weapon had a unique feel and all of them were useful, yes, even the grease gun. You had to cap all of the flags on the map and you would win the round. This might not sound groundbreaking today, but Day of Defeat was a product of its time. During the early 2000s, we had Saving Private Ryan and Band of Brothers, both of which had a huge influence on Dodd's look and feel. You couldn't play an online game or browse a forum without seeing a Captain Miller, a Liebgott, a Spears, or Captain Winter's username. Fueling the fire was the massively popular Medal of Honor series also. It was truly World War II fever back then. If I could name my favourite feature of Dodd 3.1, it would be the atmosphere. To this day, I have not experienced such an immersive sounding game. Or, maybe I have and I now take sound design for granted. Back in 2002, the presentation that was unleashed on me when I first played Dodd really blew my mind. coming from games like Team Fortress Classic and Half-Life Deathmatch, and even Delta Force, which is one of my favourite series, all of these games were pretty jumpy to say the least. To have a grounded shooter with spectacular sound design and a slower pace was so realistic to me. Thundering footsteps, booming weapon sound, and fearsome recoil, this struck a much needed chord back then, and did for thousands of other people who loved Day of Defeat. Why pew pew gauss guns when you can go full auto with an MG42? A lot of the mods' environment sounds were ripped from Saving Private Ryan. Maps would have a perfectly looped battle noise, my favourite being from the Saving Private Ryan Omaha beach scene for Dodd Overlord, the obligatory but much loved beach map for Day of Defeat 3.1. I may be the only one on the planet who has this problem, but now when I watch Saving Private Ryan's opening scene, I can pick out the exact segments of background audio that were used in the mod. It's mad, isn't it? Even though the Half-Life 1 engine looked like arse even back in 2003, I can honestly remember being floored by the immersion levels, the sound, the detailed weapon models. It was simply amazing for the time. But sound wasn't the only amazing thing about Day of Defeat. The thing that set it apart was the fact that you could pick your class and play to your strength. Both Allies and Axis had very similar weapons for balance sake, but they were unique enough to feel different, and there was never a feeling of being on the crap team, like natural selection. Sorry aliens, but you're shit. Perhaps my favourite class and experience in Dodd was the machine gunner. You'd have a machine gun with a deployable bipod for mowing down the enemy. This deploy feature basically removed recoil from your gun, so you could settle it while prone or at waist-high obstacles like sandbags. You couldn't run around hip-firing a machine gun, as the recoil would be immense, although it didn't stop some people in tight situations. The machine gun class is a prime example of being useful while not on the front. You could sit on a contested home flag and fend off players trying to cap those last flags. It's effectively camping with a devastatingly accurate automatic weapon. But the game didn't punish you or make you feel like a useless shit. You were helping the team by killing those sneaky gits who kept waiting by the last flag to try and win the game. Unlike a million camping snipers in Battlefield, sitting on your ass with a machine gun was a good strategy, and it was certainly needed in Dodd. The gameplay focus of Dodd was flag capture. Most maps had two flags which were near your spawn, and a central flag which served as a bottleneck point. These often needed two or three players to cap the point. If you kept getting stomped by the enemy, a good machine gun emplacement would really turn the tides. If you didn't fancy sitting around, you had many other playstyles to enjoy. The riflemen with their devastating Garands and K98s, the more resourceful sergeants with their SMGs, and the hard-to-master support gunners with their BARs and MP44s respectively. The support class guns had crazy recoil, but fantastic weapon damage. If you could control them, you could wipe multiple people easily. But what's the point of these classes if we don't have any good maps to play on? Well, probably Dodd's second strength is its map selection. Going back to how immersive I said Dodd was, I think a lot of that was the Half-Life 1 engine itself. Objectively, everything looks shit. The actual immersion is a few WAV sounds playing on loop. I think the actual immersion of Dodd was the fact everything looked poor and your mind filled in the gap. Much like reading a book, your mind visualises what you can't see. I think this worked in favour of Dodd and other Half-Life mods at the time. Everything seemed grittier and dirtier on the Half-Life 1 engine. Even though things rarely appeared how they should due to texture resolution, poly count and other engine limitations, your mind absolutely thought that they were the real deal. Hopefully some other people can relate to what I'm saying. The Source engine never really carried that feel with it. The Source engine just feels too clean and sterile. It's hard to describe, but I know I'm right. If you've never played Dodd and fired up Beta 3.1, you would probably just laugh, as we've been spoiled by the progression of graphics and presentation, probably so much that our minds no longer fill in the gaps. Games like Battlefield 1 look so amazing. How can our minds fill in the gaps when graphics are pretty much lifelike? Back to the maps of Dodd. Where do I start? I bet you're thinking of some favourites right now, eh? I know I am. Thunder, Overlord, Cherbourg, Zafford, Cult, Schwetz, and that one no one could ever spell correctly, Heitu, Heutau, goodness knows. Going back to how perfect the World War II theatre was for games, just look at the Dodd maps. We've got Italian mountain villages in Avalanche, snowy battles in Cult, destroyed rainy villages in Thunder, and hundreds more thanks to the community. The maps were so good because they were concise and worked with the classes. The Half-Life 1 engine did a poor job of outdoor environments, so most maps were smaller locations, but that didn't stop the Dodd team from trying their hardest to create believable environments. Much like Counter-Strike, the maps featured multiple paths to flags and often featured nooks and crannies for sneaky gameplay, but unlike Counter-Strike, Dodd let you respawn, and this allowed for bottlenecks which forced teams to work together to break a plateau and cap the central multi-man flag. Day of Defeat didn't have a ticket slash wave or limited life system. The only thing which caused the game to be over was the server's time limit, and often this could be hours depending on the server's settings. You could have multiple stalemate battles over one flag for a long time. Breaching a wall of machine gunners and snipers was such a thrilling achievement, better yet if your team went on to cap the last few flags for victory. There was another mode included in the mod when 3.0 was released, and this was Paramode. Paramode was like Counter-Strike, where respawning was disabled and the players had objectives. This was mostly planting TNT on things like German emplacements and other various items. If everyone from a team was eliminated, this also won the round. Paramode was actually removed from retail and current versions of Dodd, but more on that goodness later. Like me, I think Dodd blew a lot of people's minds. My first online games were Delta Force 1 and 2 back in 1999 to 2002. I loved Delta Force, as you'll know by watching my Delta Force videos, but gameplay wise it was pretty janky. Weapons didn't have reload animations, the sound was awful, and everything looked horribly pixelated due to the voxel engine. To come from that to this world where guns sounded incredible, you could see the reload animation of each weapon and the handmade environments. I keep bringing this up, but this really was something to be seen at the time. Look at other games out during this time period. Not that it would have been possible for me to play every game and give it fair judgment, especially on a young teen's budget, but I would say Day of Defeat was one of the most realistic looking and sounding games from a presentation standpoint by a country mile. I'd also go on a limb and say Dodd may have had the best gunplay of its time, at least for a finger quotes arcade shooter. Comparing other games at the time, it was all blasty stuff with crosshairs and point and shooting. Day of Defeat was fairly unforgiving. It had sharp recoil on all guns, it penalised you for shooting on the move, and encouraged controlled gunfire and crouching. This was shown visually by the game's crosshair, which was almost like a tiny gun sight, and when you moved, the central point moved around to emulate weapon sway. You had to wait for this little eye shape to stop moving to ensure a perfect shot. It was certainly unique. Look out for it in this video. You can tell the beta 3.1 footage, as it has this strange red crosshair and a thumping heart on the heads-up display. What I like about the gun mechanics is, you can be effective with full auto if you can control the crazy recoil. There's no false cone of fire like most shooters have. If you can aim under fire, then you're mostly going to get all shots on point. This is not to say all shots are laser accurate, but you won't be missing people right in front of you. Your only handicap is your own skill, which I think is such a missing factor from today's games. If you can control a beastly BAR firing full auto while standing, then you deserve to kill the people you aim at. I'd hesitate to call Dodd an arcade shooter, to be honest. There's no aim down the sight, bearing in mind this was not a thing yet, and the pace can be kind of frantic. I could call it probably Simcade. Weapons do pretty good damage, a slower pace is rewarded, and it can be kind of plodding. I'll leave it up to the vets to decide. It's easy to call it arcade now with the tryhard games we have available, but in the mid-2000s it was definitely more realism based. Hard to argue when the rival MP games were TFC and Ricochet. Another great feature to set Dodd apart from the rest was the inclusion of a bleeding mechanic. if you landed a non-fatal shot, your opponent would slowly bleed out until they bandaged themselves. It added such a layer to the game, it was sorely missed when it was removed. Remember when I mentioned about how stalemated some battles could get? Bleeding was handy because you could injure a lot of soldiers and really break up groups of enemies because they had to scuttle off and heal themselves. Most would retreat to heal, and that provided you with a chance to attack. Bleeding was basically a health drain for X seconds until you pressed a button to heal. Healing took around 10 seconds if I recall, your classic risk versus reward style action. It may not sound like much, but its removal started the slow trickle that was Day of Defeat's decline. In May 2003, Day of Defeat 1.0 Retail was released. Obviously, a short time before this, it was known that Valve had acquired the Day of Defeat team. Personally, I don't have any interest in nuggets of info from this time. I think on the forums we were leaked the inclusion of the British Army and a few screenshots showing some improved visual fidelity. All I can say is nothing was the same after Retail. It was literally all downhill from here. But before I move on to Dodd Retail and beyond, I wanted to talk about mods and perhaps the best mod scene that ever was. I didn't know what this Half-Life game was, to be honest. Around that time period, I was still mainly a console gamer. My PC games were Flight Sims, 3D Movie Maker, Delta Force, and whatever freebies I got given, really. Everyone on Delta Force kept going on about this game called Counter-Strike. Regarding Counter-Strike, all I kept hearing from players on Delta Force was, "It's kind of like Delta Force, but way better." It was all I kept hearing. So I thought I'd try it out. I grabbed myself a copy of Half-Life, which was the Generations pack with Counter-Strike, Op 4, Blue Shift and Half-Life included. I didn't know at the time, you know, how much awesomeness I was about to experience. But for now, all I knew was that I had to install this shitty Half-Life game and download a patch. What is a patch? To get it working. All I'll say was that Christmas was spent downloading the Counter-Strike and Half-Life patches and trying to get them to work. Before 2004, we were stuck with the ever so shitty WON network, or WON network, whatever it was called. It was so early 2000s you wouldn't really understand unless you experienced it. Much like Day of Defeat, I was blown away by Counter-Strike's visual fidelity over the guff that I had been playing, picking up guns, watching reload animations. It was all a visual overload for me. PC gaming was so crisp compared to the PlayStation 2. So I was finally in the Half-Life Club, but I didn't really know what a modding scene was. A mod is a game within a game? What? A friend told me to download this war mod called Day of Defeat back in school. So I did. Sure, it took me 6 hours on a 56k modem, but it was worth it. Ooh, 100 megabytes of it, I might add. I fired the mod up, and the rest was history. But what I didn't realise was that for these games, we got free updates, and players could even influence changes by moaning on a forum. Could you imagine a team of people today making a game for free? It simply wouldn't happen. Today, we need Patreon, Kickstart, or X, Y, or Z to get a project off the ground. Mods were little projects which grew at their own pace. Some were more successful than others. Day of Defeat and Counter-Strike were the best examples. And in third place, I would say Natural Selection took that position. But the Natural Selection devs never got a retail deal with Valve. They did go on to make the NS2 standalone later on, which sadly didn't do tremendously well. Aliens are still shit, by the way. Mods could be little single-player stories using Half-Life assets to full-blown conversions. I won't bother listing off the many single-player mods because there are loads, but multiplayer mods were pretty tremendous. I'll just fire some off now. First up, we have Natural Selection, which had you play as aliens and marines, an almost RTS-type game where games could last hours. Oh, the days of when I had hours just for gaming. Firearms was another, a zany shooter which I never really understood. I loved the feel of the guns in this. It had that similar realism feeling that Day of Defeat 3.1 had, but it was a modern shooter. It had a weird setting, weird voice acting, and I think it was a mix of Vietnam or some kind of late war mishmash. I liked it, but it also annoyed the hell out of me. I recall the firefights being really annoying and random. probably one of my favourites was The Specialists, a Matrix-inspired mod where you could slow down time, do dive-in rolls and smash through windows. A phenomenal mod which had a huge skill window to try and learn. The gun mechanics in this mod were absolutely amazing. Again, they felt totally unique to the mod, even though it is in the Half-Life 1 engine. If you run into some fucker that mastered the melee combat, oh, you're in for a bad day, trust me. Next up is The Ship, a funky game where you're on a ship and you had to kill your rival. I personally never played much, but I appreciated the art style. Check out some images to see what I mean. It's very sort of 1920s, extremely unique, and you wouldn't even think it's on the Half-Life 1 engine. Sven Co-op. Sven is still going strong today. You and a bunch of others go through mostly custom maps, killing AI-controlled enemies. It was made a standalone Steam game in 2016. It's absolutely worth checking out. It's just easy going, it's fun. Check it out, honestly. Next up is Earth's Special Forces, another mention due to its technical achievement. This was a Dragon Ball Z mod where you could fight each other and use powers. It had some unique mechanics which are more impressive than fun. I wasn't into it, so I never mastered it, but it was really impressive to see what could be done with the Half-Life engine. Probably the most obscure one on this list, that is Hostile Intent. This was a weird anomaly that appeared on the tail end of the mod scene. Hostile Intent was kind of like Counter-Strike, but with ramped up difficulty. We had iron sights, high damage, and slow movement speed. It was short-lived, but I remember it fondly for its approach. Science and Industry. I personally have never played this, but this was everyone's jam. I saw it on forums everywhere, everyone loves it, loved it. I just never played it. Although I just found out that it's still being developed. Amazing. A very quirky concept, I'd recommend you check it out. And one more, Battlegrounds. This was a shitty looking but fun concept mod based around the Revolutionary War. You all had muskets, which were inaccurate as shit, and reload times between your single shot was about 10 seconds, no joke. It may have been one of those had to be there moments, but I remember having so much fun with this. What I loved about mods were their rough edges. Things like a cheap looking UI or shoddy skins just didn't matter back then. It was so cool to see mods get better with patches. You could see the mod teams get better with each update. An early mod version was primitive, but you could see the appeal of the concept the devs were trying to make. Again, I think it must be the Half-Life engine and the mind-filling blanks thing. Now imagine all of these communities pushing out patches and media posts. I remember some weekends multiple mod teams would release a new version and you'd have so much to play. All of these mods were not just rinky-dink projects, these had fully-fledged assets and maps. I never modded the Half-Life engine other than some texture work, but it was either really easy or these folks had a lot of free time. I think it must be because modern games are so lifelike now, you can't crash out some weapon models and maps and call it a day anymore. I guess I answered my own question as to why everyone needs a crowdfunding source now. It's a real shame. I would legit take the Half-Life engine today, but with modern capabilities such as open worlds, increased player counts, something like that. It really felt like the Half-Life 1 engine could do anything. If it wasn't for the dead communities and my horrible field of view on my ultra-wide monitor, I would still love to play Half-Life mods. I still play Sven Co-op from time to time, as there are still lots of people having fun with that. Going back to my main point of being part of a mod community, it was so exciting to hang around on the forums to see what the progress of the mod was, and to see the patch notes. Ugh, they changed something, boo, and it gets changed back in the next patch. All of this was for free. When I think about it, it's sad that most modern day gamers will never experience the community of modding. Sure, we do have mods today, but they're in short supply, or developers frown upon it or cock-block it entirely with their own shitty DLC. It kills me when some game mods are simply reskins for existing assets because that's the only thing allowed within the engine. I am glad that we do have Steam Workshop and ModDB around, but most mods now are just asset changes. A mod is a total conversion, in my opinion. There was definitely something to finding a crusty old link on File Planet or File Shack and installing mods manually to your Half-Life folder and just being privy to a whole new community just like that. we do have some great effort mods out there, such as Call of Chernobyl, a mod for Stalker, Call of Pripyat. It puts all of the Stalker levels together, does some much needed fixes and lots more, but it's more of a mishmash and collaboration of tweaks rather than a fresh concept or feel. But it's the best we're going to get from mods today, I would say. There's not an army of people smashing out new concepts within game engines anymore. It's dead. It's no longer a thing. I think those folks moved on to polluting Steam with small titles. Fair play to them. Back to DoD and modifying game assets. Or how about modifying mod assets? You'd only be talking about one of the best things to do with DoD or any Half-Life mod if the community workforce was there. There was a mod scene within the mods you played. How crazy is that? I used to love modding DoD. You could grab new weapon models which featured new animations, new sound packs, although these were mostly ripped from other games and movies to provide even better sound work. More often than not, these sounds were looped horribly or their frequencies and noise levels were way off. But it's the fact that we had a choice of content that was so cool at the time. I remember the DoD Editing Center, ran by Editor321. It was a website full of mods for DoD. You could grab new faction skins, new scope sprites, new everything basically. It goes without saying, maps were the most modded and popular things. It was a matter of dropping files into the correct folder and it would appear in your game. Switching out some amazing weapon models or new sounds was just part of the DoD experience. I always liked the Medal of Honor Allied Assault Garand, so I had it in DoD. Even with the retail DoD version, this sub-community thrived. The amount of hours people spent modelling weapons, goodness knows what, only to be a passing mention in a video about DoD in 2017. Well, I definitely appreciated all of that hard work and effort. Cheers, mod makers. Even though DoD retail allowed modding of assets, it was one of the few positives that came with the retail deal. I'll start by saying retail DoD is a good game, with nothing fundamentally wrong. The mod fanatics like me are just hardcore and loved the game for what it was. Think of the Star Wars Galaxies MMO debacle that ruined the game. It's that sort of thing. Mods are non-commercial works, so when DoD went retail, a few things had to change, such as the sound design. Gone were the ripped Saving Private Ryan environment sounds, replaced with flat little tinkles of a battle zone, clearly made up. The weapon sounds are mostly replaced with inferior versions, the Thompson being the most egregious. Oof. A lot of the grit from DoD was in its sound design, and this was lost in the jump to retail. We all played the mods so much that every facet of the game was burned into our memory. So in things like reduced footstep noise and subtle changes were made to weapon mechanics, we all spotted them and wondered why. I'd say the most disappointing change overall was the look of the game. Remember when I said DoD 3.1 looked gritty as shit? Well, it all changed in retail. I can kind of guess why, but I don't understand. The weapon models in the mod were all scratched up and dirty looking. The maps dripped atmosphere. It looked like hell. retail rolled around and the weapons had been polished to a mirror finish and the maps had been tidied up by little stagehands or something. I can only assume this was a Valve direction made for the mass market, even though in 2003 I don't think the market was that big for a mostly unknown World War II shooter appearing on the shelves suddenly. The passion in my wording is starting to come out, the nerve has finally been struck. Ah, mate, they really mucked around with Dodd, and it annoyed a lot of the community that loved the game. But the most legendary change was the removal of bleeding. Valve pissed on your family and burnt your house down. Whatever. Valve removed bleeding from Dodd. What? Are you fucking kidding me? It might sound super embellished now, but it was a real shitstorm when everyone found out bleeding was removed. I remember the constant bring back bleeding threads on the Dodd forums, which had turned to a light green from its old black theme, by the way. According to my research, bleeding was removed because testers didn't understand the need to bandage and kept dying, so dumbing things down has always been a thing, really. They also removed the CS-style para mode, which was a shame, as these had little cutscenes at the start of the map, and they were very unique. The para maps were kept in, but they were made to be standard maps, or maps with objectives such as blowing stuff up with satchels, or shooting at static objects with the new rocket class. They was a bit wank. The actual additions in Dodd Retail were the British Army and the rocket class. Each army had a rocket launcher for some reason. Other than objective-based maps, these were fairly useless. I do recall some maps having destructible hulls, but overall, these were kind of useless in my opinion. Another annoying little thing was the removal of the class skins. Each class had a unique look, be it a tanker's jacket or some flecked-on camo, but Retail made all of the soldiers generic. Boo. Retail did bring in some good maps though. Forest, Cult, Charlie, which was the new Omaha Beach map, it had some pretty fun objectives, so it was alright. Thankfully, old maps could be converted and played on, but most people played the stock ones, as you can imagine. Some other little tweaks were the inclusion of a mini-map, which was a bugbear for some hardcore players, but I didn't mind the addition. We've got some annoying bulldogs which popped up as a notification, you know, if you're out of ammo, it goes, pressure to reload. It was just annoying and most people were scratching their heads like, what on earth is this shit? So in a nutshell, Dodd Retail was an okay game. If you've never played the mod, you still probably loved it when it came out in 2003. This video is literally for a small collection of fans, all of which are probably in their 30s and beyond now. Long live Dodd Mod. If you're wondering about playing Dodd 3.1 today, you can't unfortunately. You can install the mod to your Steam directory and get it running, but much like my footage in this video, you'll be running around by yourself looking at the maps. There aren't any functioning bots for the game on Steam, as it's literally the one version packaged for a Steam install. The bots that used to work are designed for the old non-Steam Half-Life and simply do not work. A few people tried to get them working, but nothing ever happened. Actually, before I move on to Dodd Source, I just want to say about Steam and when it was released. FYI, I think Dodd was probably the first game to be properly launched on Steam. Remember what I said earlier about WON or WON? Well, WON was basically a shitty server browser for Half-Life and its mods. It was just a piece of shit from what I can remember. I remember the PC windows being so tetchy as well. They couldn't alt-tab very well, they kept crashing. I have no real good memories, other than Half-Life mods had a cool graphic loading screen when you joined games. That's about it, I would say. When I found out Steam ditched WON in favour of their own server browsers and EXEs, I was so happy. I could alt-tab out of Dodd and other games quickly without crashing. Steam was really cool. Everyone hated it so much at first, but I loved the concept. I'm glad it's as big as it is today. Valve totally deserve, they just deserve being number one for being so ballsy back in 2004. So now that we have Steam and Half-Life 2, finally, Counter-Strike Source came about, and it was really cool to see how a Half-Life 1 game looked on the Source engine. We had ragdolls, lovely particle effects, improved poly count and textures. Wow, how cool. But what about Day of Defeat? What about Day of Defeat? I don't really remember too much rumour and innuendo over Dodd Source being developed and released. I think it was kind of low-key and was pushed out. I'm speaking from memory, so I may be wrong, but surely I would remember anything significant from the time. I do remember a leaked screenshot of the Anzio map with some Half-Life 1 American soldiers, you know, with some cool source engine lighting. That was about the only sniff we got of it. I'm certain most of the community was in the dark and, you know, we were all just sitting around patiently for news of release. It finally came out on September 26, 2005, after a preload on Steam. How exciting, this Steam thing, preloading. Oh my. What can I say about Dodd's source that's positive? The graphical fidelity, I guess. I always said the Half-Life 1 engine looked gritty, and source always looked too clean. Well, this World War II game looked too bloody clean. Even more polished than Dodd Retail. In Dodd's source, everything was new. We had iron sights for the riflemen. The SMG class could melee punch, I really wanted that. The Brits were removed, and so were a lot of the maps, and the gameplay overall was shit. Pretty much covers it, so the end. What I said is probably a bit sweeping, but it's kind of true at the same time. Dodd had a lot of character, and it still retains some of it in the Half-Life 1 version. But Dodd's source really did a number on the franchise. Perhaps Valve shifted around the Dodd project team and things changed. We'll never know, sadly. It's a shame because I remember the developers of the mod being fairly active on the forums. You know, they loved interacting with the players and whatnot. You had Wally, who was the, you know, one of the map creators, and you had Fuzzdad, who I remember. His little avatar was like a little dog. One of those things that you would add water and the grass would grow through the mould of the thing. It was like this little dog. And there was an Easter egg on one of the maps, I believe it was Dodd Glider. And you'd find this clip of him, and I remember exactly what it said. He went, "Fuzzdad here, I may not be very good at what I do, but at least I'm slow." Why the fuck do I remember that? You know, it might be some throwaway little nuggets of knowledge, but I don't think I'm ever going to have memories of games like that ever again, and I think it's sad, you know? So, there you have it. I know we sort of get the same thing with like early access titles. You've got forums, you know, 7 Days to Die being one of them, Bugbear for Wreckfest, a couple of my favourites. You can speak with the developers and have a little, you know, chat with them, but it's no longer casual and, you know, warm-hearted, is what I'm trying to say. It's all business now. I don't know. Will it change? I'm not the one to say, sadly. Moving back onto Dodd's source and why I think it's so crap. Well, we were left with this generic boring shooter with some reminiscent maps and some shitty new ones that used Half-Life 2 assets. I just disliked it so much. Everything felt spongy, the weapon noises sounded cheap, it was genuinely boring, the grit was gone, it just felt poor overall. I couldn't write a longer argument other than it was shit, to be honest. It wasn't broken, it just lacked character and content. The classes were dumbed down and the Dodd feel was just savaged, replaced by this robot Doddtron thing that was the Source release. It was horrid. If Dodd Source was your first Dodd experience, how did you like it coming from not playing Half-Life Dodd? I'd love to know if you thought it was like genuinely good or just another bland FPS game. The community pretty much shat on Dodd S, and that was, you know, the final nail in Day of Defeat's coffin. It was just a total blunder. There has been no further news, patches or otherwise for the Day of Defeat franchise. Valve has gone full Nova Logic on us regarding our favourite World War II shooter. People have been wanting the CSGO treatment for Dodd, but even I think that's a dumb idea. Other than nicer graphics, what is there on offer? Sadly, there are better and much more capable games out there now, and even more in 2017 and beyond. If Medal of Honor can fall out of grace with gamers, then a little community born from a mod certainly can. Day of Defeat had a passionate community with an active forum and a large player base with clans. As the years went on, these things just died away. Dodd's source splintered the community, with those playing the original remaining quite happy. I think the source migrators were expecting more of the same, but were left disappointed and just said fuck it to Dodd altogether. It's rare to hear the name Day of Defeat anymore, other than a nostalgic post on Reddit. It's a passing mention when it's brought up. Will we ever see it again? I think it's gone forever personally, especially with Valve no longer making games. Who would pick up this tired old shooter and try and revive it? Even though Dodd is long and forgotten mostly, it's not all doom and gloom though. Thankfully, there is some hope for Day of Defeat fans coming up in the future. As I mentioned in the opener, there is a little twinkle of hope for World War II gamers on the horizon. There's a game called Day of Infamy which is currently in early access. It's a standalone game based off of the Insurgency game, which is a Source Engine game. Insurgency, like DoD, is a more realism than arcade game, but not quite a full sim shooter. Weapons hurt, but the pace is fairly quick. Day of Infamy is a total love letter to DoD, even recreating maps like Avalanche. Day of defeats D-Dust, Khan and Rommel, or Murderette as it was renamed in DoD retail. This was the bridge from Saving Private Ryan, and a great map. It's great to experience his classics once more in Day of Infamy. If I was part of the Day of Infamy dev team, I would totally sell out and just remaster the DoD maps, because you could never have enough good maps, I'd say. Either that or make a community map pack to prevent people moaning about DOI ripping off DoD. I currently play Day of Infamy's co-op mode. You move through a map fighting against hard bots and attempt to cap points. If you die before capping a point, you don't respawn. It's a fun mode with a sense of urgency. Officers can call in artillery and Stuka bombing runs. It can sometimes feel like a scripted single player game where everyone is forced to work together. If you run off and lone wolf, you're just gonna die. On the contrary, I currently dislike the multiplayer mode, only because it uses a limited wave system. Some games you can only die 3 times and the game is over. It's a bit stupid in my opinion. I'd rather it be unlimited and the game on a timer. For instance, in Day of Infamy's Omaha Beach map, the US team only get 3 chances to attack. If they're all wiped out on one of the bloodiest one-sided arena maps of all times, the round ends. It's just clunky and pointless, I find. On a lasting positive note, the shooting mechanics are great and reward skill, and it also has some of the best suppression effects in any FPS game I've seen. It's still early access, but the developers are actually competent for once. Insurgency, DOI's sister game, still receives content updates, and I expect nothing less for the smooth development of Day of Infamy. Really, check it out. Ignore the morons slagging it off. It's cheap, boots on the ground, World War II gaming fun with tidy mechanics, and it's only going to get better. Another game coming out via Kickstarter, which utterly smashed its goals, is Battalion 1944. This is meant to be a love letter for Call of Duty 2 fans who just want iron sights and boots on the ground. They're not focusing on any gimmicks, just the feel of old proper shooters. Check them out. We expect something early this year, so they keep saying. And lastly, the other significant project in the works is Days of War. If you Google them, you'll spot DoD Donna instantly. Again, it's another tribute-style shooter with familiar maps. I'm all for people wanting and making these games like the old mod days. I'm in the mindset of show me, don't tell me at the moment, but as soon as they come out, I will certainly play them. I'm itching badly for some modern World War II shooters. Battlefield 1 was so good, I can only imagine what the current day AAA treatment is going to do for all of our favourite World War II theatres of war. Omaha Beach with all of those characters, with Battlefield style fidelity, good lord. World War II lends itself so well to gaming. You shoot at the turquoise Germans, the green Americans, or the brown Englishmen with big, beefy iron sights. Job done. Hopefully, 2017 will mark the return of World War II games. Hell, it's been 10 years now. Surely that's enough for a fresh cycle, right? If you're sick of them, simply don't play them. I've been doing that quietly for years with all of the future guff that's been coming out recently. Give me a K98 and some heads to pop, please. We've waited long enough now. So, in closing, people are still having fun with DoD today. Although, if anything has changed from the last time I tried to play, most servers are full of bots, full of non-English speaking potato PC playing Russians, or full of elite class players who will pinshot you with a K98 through the entire map. Or, the map rotation is full of stupid junk like orange maps. Hopefully there are some good servers full of actual players out there. I managed to find some while recording for this video, so you should be able to too. No one will probably communicate with you and you'll probably get wrecked, but at least you can still experience the game in 2017. Day of Defeat's heyday was very short for the time period, when you look at it on a calendar, but hopefully this was some fan service to some DoD veterans. I'd love to hear some thoughts and old stories about the good old DoD days. Thank you for watching. And if you still want some more Dodd fun, stick around. I'm going to cobble some footage together of 3.1, probably comparing some modern retail stuff, having a bit of a ramble in another video. So keep an eye out for it, and thank you once again for watching.